So hello friends, so here in this series of lecture we are discussing alphabets of ethics, which we have named as. In this we are basically taking the basic terminologies, the fundamental terminologies and fundamental concepts. Okay, and like we are into this 14th lecture, and increasingly we have been seeing that ethics paper is becoming more and more important. Today we would be discussing Indian philosophy. Okay, Indian philosophy is very important as far as your whole gamut of GS paper 4 is concerned. Not only that, even in PT from 2005, maybe even before that, one or two question always comes from Indian philosophy. Every time it has to come, whether it is Jainism, Syadvad, Anekantvad or Buddhism, Shunyavad, it has to come. Okay, and as you have seen in this particular year ethics paper, questions were very questions are basically evolving. Now question can truly be called as questions from ethics paper. Okay, and not only that, you also saw in essay paper questions related to awareness, questions related to the ship would drown, only water gets into, like all the eight essay topic came directly from ethics paper. Okay, so today we would be discussing briefly the Indian philosophy. In this I have taken a question that has come from 2023 A question. Actually I could have taken many questions, I could have taken whole of the essay paper, but you can visit to any website and a UPSC website and you can see the questions that has come. Okay, but this question just I have taken to exemplify that Indian philosophy is an omnipresent thing as far as UPSC is concerned. Okay, so the question was, what teachings of Buddha are most relevant today and why? Okay, before getting into that question, we would discuss that there are basically, let me say, there are principal school of philosophy. Okay, there are different school of philosophy rather. Okay, main school of philosophy are basically divided into two parts, orthodox and heterodox. In common parlance, we understand orthodox in a very different manner. But here, orthodox means different. Orthodox school of philosophy, under which many other philosophies comes, orthodox school of philosophy is also called as astic. Astic. That means they are basically thir. They are basically stable on a particular object. Astic. Okay. Orthodox. Again, astic. Do not confuse with like popular parlance, astic is a person who believes in God, all those things. Because whatever we use in popular parlance, the terminology have very different technical meaning. Okay. The second is a heterodox school of thought, that is also called Gnostic, naturally. Orthodox, heterodox, it is called astic and it is called Gnostic. Actually, astic people believes in the authority of Veda. Rig, Yajur, Sam, Atharva, Upanishad. Okay, they believe in the authority of Veda and they regard Veda as aparishya. That means Vedas has not been written by any individual. It has come directly from God. So one thing is one thing leads to another thing. In corollary, that means astic people, since they think that Vedas has been written by God, so they are basically theistic people. But primary definitional context is that they believe in the authority of Vedas. Okay, then they believe in metaphorical entities like Dev means Ishwar or God. Okay, when you get into philosophy, Ishwar and Brahma also has different meaning. Okay, then they believe in the metaphorical entities like soul, God, world, GSW. Okay, so this is the context of orthodox philosophy. In heterodox philosophy or Gnostic philosophy, they do not believe in the authority of God. Since they do not believe in the authority of God, they do not believe in metaphorical entities like God, soul, world. They are atheistic. Okay. So when we come to orthodox or Gnostic school of thought, actually we have principally five philosophy which basically believes in this particular orthodox. Okay. And those are Nyaya philosophy, Vaisheshik philosophy. Nyaya, Vaisheshik. Nyaya and Vaisheshik are regarded together. Nyaya and Vaisheshik. Why? Because the basic epistemology and metaphysics. Epistemology means that valid source of knowledge, how they regard that particular context, whether it is valid source of knowledge or invalid source of knowledge. Okay, we cannot get into those things because then again lecture would be stretched. Okay, so Nyaya and Vaisheshik basically are coupled together. So Nyaya and Vaisheshik are orthodox, Sankhya philosophy is orthodox, Yog philosophy is orthodox. Like Nyaya and Vaisheshik are regarded in as coupled, Sankhya and Yog are also regarded as coupled. Okay, then Mimamsa philosophy is also called as Purva Vedanta because it just came before Vedanta of Shankaracharya, and then is Vedanta. Okay, so these five school of thought, Nyaya Vaisheshik, Sankhya, Yoga, Mimamsa and Vedanta, are orthodox. Heterodox philosophy, which do not believe in the authority of Vedas or God, are basically Jain, Buddhist, Ajivika, Agyan and Charvaka. Charvaka philosophy is also called as Lokayak. They are actually hedonist. We have discussed hedonism in our previous lecture. Okay, ethical hedonism, psychological hedonism. You can revert back to my previous lecture. Okay, so now we come briefly into this context. Okay, actually you have to know two more things. Okay, first is metaphysics and second is epistemology. Okay, see, metaphysics basically is particular object, particular entity. It could be God, it could be soul, or it could be world. How to know metaphysics is epistemology. Epistemology means, epistemology is also called as pramanas. Pramanas. In Indian philosophy, it is called pramanas. Pramanas means valid source of knowledge. If everything is happening in a very refined manner, and this particular refined manner has been defined differently by different philosophy, that leads to praman, that is valid source of knowledge, and that leads to correct knowledge of metaphysics. Okay, correct knowledge of padartha, object. Okay, so pramanas in Indian philosophy basically are four. They are perception, they are inference, they are verbal testimony, and they are comparison. Other philosophy has also included some more into that, okay, but we would not be getting into that. Principle is perception, inference, verbal testimony, and pramanas to some extent. Okay, different philosophy has different number of pramanas which they include as valid source of knowledge. Okay, for example, Buddhist philosophy, they basically regard perception and inference as praman. Naturally, they have to regard perception and inference. Perception means what you are directly observing, and inference is what you are basically anuman, that is called as anuman, what you are inferring after you are perceiving something, and then you are creating your own picture of that particular perception, and that is called as inference. Naturally, Buddhist has to believe in perception and inference only for the simple reason that they do not believe in authority of Vedas, okay, and they do not believe in soul. To some extent, later Buddhist philosophers believed in the Pitaka, Sut Pitaka, Vinay Pitaka, that means they believed in the words of Buddha, but then those were words of Buddha, so that those cannot be equated with Vedas. Okay, so you cannot say that since they believed in the sayings of Buddha, so verbal testimony can also be regarded as one of the praman. No, verbal testimony is regarded as praman only when that particular philosophy is orthodox. Okay, so now we come to what teachings of Buddha are most relevant today. Okay, actually see, Buddha did not say anything related to our Astha. He was a very scientific thinker. He was a scientific philosopher. In fact, he was the first scientific philosopher from India. He talked in a very logical and rational manner. He did not indulge himself into things that you cannot experience. In fact, while he was dying, he said to Anand, his nephew, he said to Anand that apo dipo bhava, you have to experience yourself and you have to become your own diya, your own light. Similar thing was also talked by Socrates when he was dying. He said that gnothi stautan, or he said know thyself. Okay, so these philosophers were basically scientific, and naturally scientific they were. They did not said anything related to God. Okay, so basically the teachings of Buddha is dependent upon his four cardinal truths. World is full of suffering. Suffering is caused by human desire. Human desire can be understood or can be controlled by following certain path, and there is a path to salvation. Ashtang Yoga. Okay, those four cardinal truths basically is the axis of Buddha. Okay, so Buddha said that you cannot run away from suffering. Okay, you just have to concede to this fact that till you are alive you have to suffer in this world. You have to become old, you would get disease. Okay, you would die one day anyway. The moment we are born, the clock starts to tick. Okay, we all are standing on our death. In fact, anthropologists say that every person is standing on 10 dead bodies. You and I would be the 11th dead body. We have come from this earth and then again we would get into this earth. Okay, so Buddha said that this world basically is full of suffering. He basically came up with a very novel perspective, and that was being a drashta, being a sakshi, being aware. Because he said that the past moment exists only to produce the present moment, and present moment exists only to produce the future moment. There is no other utility. Okay, there is no other utility. This principle of causation only made him to come to this conclusion that you just have to be aware of this particular moment. It is very easy. I am telling, it doesn't mean that I know that. I am still experimenting that particular fact or particular aspect with my own self. You just have to be aware. If anything is happening, like you are a public servant, if any hangama or any mob, maybe tractor rally, maybe something, those people hoisted their flag, their religious flag, okay, on the red fort, okay. If you are a DCP employed, they are deployed there as your field duty, then you just have to take action on the moment. And you know, this particular teaching of Buddha only later on led to other sort of martial arts, that was like Kung Fu, Taekwondo, because they remain at that particular moment. So in today's world of fast movement, instant gratification, consumption, materialism, like instant, everything is instant. The whole life is on an instant coffee. You just have to be aware. Self-awareness. Okay, to become drashta, to become sakshi. Okay, and that was the biggest teaching. That was the greatest teaching. That is in fact more applicable today than it was ever. Because of all the changes, the rapid changes that is happening. Every day we are waking up and something new technical intervention is coming up. Some new app is coming. Now you have to submit your paper with new format. You have to give examination online. Your assignments are not getting submitted nicely. Maybe internet connection got off. You are attending an online class. That is very important. So you get completely rattled. Buddha says that you do not even have to suppress that feeling that you are getting rattled. You are getting rattled, okay. Because you are a human being, you have to get rattled. But you just have to see that who is getting rattled is not me. You stand somewhere, like you create a distance between that entity which is getting rattled and yourself. You just observe. This is very difficult, But you introspect, maybe you would get to that particular context. Okay, so this was the brief analysis of Indian philosophy. Hope you are liking my video, because all the videos that I have discusses in some way, like discusses and has a direct coherence with the questions that has come till now. So I would also recommend, I would request you to visit the question papers, at least past 3 year question paper. Okay, maybe then you would appreciate my video more. Thank you very much.